Thank you for the artistic director of the manor. So I don't want to talk very much because I usually don't like to talk very much. I know a lot of people are here who feel that, which is wonderful. I just want to say, I think who we are as the manor, our identity, I think has been shaped a lot by the ensemble theatres that we have had and continue to have here at the manor. So it's really wonderful to have the network of ensemble theatres here with the new school and this conference to kind of explore where we come from, where we are now, and how we can all work together in the future. So this is very exciting for us. So thank you so much. And now I'm going to introduce to you Vicky, Victoria Brush from the new school. Evening.
Broadway, which we didn't have on Broadway, all right? And also, they bought the t-shirts, the tie-dye, all right?
audience and the relationship, you redefine the effects that theater had on the contemporary audience. This theater is an embodiment of Eller's idea of mobility and accessibility to whoever and whatever. We can do the Kabuki in the theater, we can also do the Ramayana, we can also do the Kathakali, because the theater is mobile. It is made to the disposition of the artist, not to satisfy any architectural necessity. Understand? It's very important. She learned this because we went on tour. We went on tour and presented 12 plays, Lambert Wilson, Leonard Murphy, Rochelle Owens, Paul Foster. Many of these plays all went on tour. They went to Copenhagen and they went to Paris, and they came back. We went on tour so we can get critiques because the American critics would not honor us. They wouldn't look at us. But of course, once we came back from Europe, with critiques from Europe, everybody wanted to know who the hell we were. We were in, okay? The definition of what is important suddenly becomes fashionable. It's a very, very, very important time. All of this was happening simultaneously. But the diversity is what was so beautiful, okay? At one of the other companies, we had the Marble Lines. There's a glass around the Colitis, Ruth Malachek and Brewer. Incredible material. They were adaptive. They started here looking at Beckett, okay? And they created their own incredible things. Combinations of elements. Performance art started as a result of, not I'm a dancer or I'm a singer or I only tap or whatever. As a result of ensembles coming together and saying, I want to explore the possibility of this. How can we do that? We also had the Fiji Company, Big John, magnificent visuals. Unbelievable perception. Now, along with all of this at the time, and this is what you must remember, because it was a closed circuit in the commercial theater, we had the GBA Nucleus, the Yarborough Company, which later, members of which later went on to become the Negro Ensemble Theater. We presented the buildings, we presented Lindsay Lee's plays here, later on, they created. There was no black theater at the time on the commercial stage. We also had the Dua Theater. Hispanics come from all over, all different parts of the world, primarily Cuba, as a result of the revolution. Artists were not able to function in their own country, but they were given the opportunity to present their work here. And then we had the MoMA Chinatown, something Ellen created, which gave the opportunity to all of the American Asians and any Asians that wished to perform, because there was no representation in the commercial theater. In doing that, we opened the doors to so many possibilities and such a rich, rich heritage of we remember that Ellen was the one who opened those doors. She opened the doors for women directors, she opened the doors for women playwrights. There weren't that many women playwrights and directors on Broadway at the time. It was a whole other ballgame. Okay? In changing the culture of the American theater, you just contributed to the world theater. In going on an international stage and sending American plays, you changed the perception of what was American. Because in 1961, what was American in most of the European countries was Hollywood. Everybody was Rock Hudson and Doris Day with 2.5 dogs and 2.5 kids and 2.5 car garage. This is what they said from Hollywood. We weren't exporting anything else. But when you send Tom Horrigan and Andrew Wilson, you send Rochelle Owens, things change. Suddenly the perception is, oh my God, the Americans do have a mind. And they are concerned about the things that are going on in the world, and they are very much a part of. Okay? Very important we understand. It was a revolutionary time that gave birth to a very necessary thing. There was no blueprint. Nobody said we're going to do it this way. Everybody said, what are the possibilities? And Ellen said, do it here. Show it to your friends. Show it to your fellow artists, etc. I'm just going to run through this very quickly. And we finally ended up with things like the ETC Company. Wilfred Leach came from Sarah Lawrence. He founded the ETC Company here. He became an artistic director here. He went on to Broadway to do Mystery of Edwin Drood and Pirates of Penzance and got to Tony's Warner. Right? So the MoMA becomes a stepping stone for some very important creative people. And it worked together. His whole ensemble of people who could sing, who could dance, who could do everything that was necessary. The other thing that Ellen did was she inspired a whole new awareness for the actor and for the performer. Because every time we went to Europe, we were performing in a space that heretofore had nothing to do with the American theater. You performed in a Roman arena, you performed in a piazza, you performed in a cantina or in a quarry. You had to be ready to do the same show in 2 days in some place that you had never been before. So all you could do was listen to the director and say, yes, I want you on the top of that, and then you come running down here, you run over to there, and you do that line over there. Okay? This is an experience that, quite honestly, no actor in America was getting. You're never going to find gold angels hanging from the ceiling here. All right? They're never going to be velvet seats for you, you know, to swivel in or whatever. Okay? The theater has to be at the service of the artist. And that's one of the things she instilled. The other thing she did was these very important ensembles generated a new awareness of what it meant to connect with an audience. If you are in Turkey and nobody understands what the hell you're talking about, it's your fault. You are the artist. You haven't done enough to communicate. And if it's your piece, you have to do something to communicate. And what do you have to do? You use music, you use mime, you use costumes, you use lights, you use tap dance, you use anything you have to use to get across what your art is about. And this is something that contributed on a huge scale to global representation of theater around the world. Okay? Ellen was a genius. Not that she was aware. We did things by fault. Okay? Everything we did was illegal, not because we were bandits, but because everything was had not been done before. It's very simple. So we were constantly at the frontier of something, whether we liked it or not. And we found out later on that, you know, it was illegal. But that's okay. That's okay. We had already done it, the world had seen it, we were made our mark. Anyway. And then of course somebody else copied it and got a lot more money to do it.
Start our event. So what we're wondering right now is you pick up on where Ozzy left us and hear from the folks who have been through here and their work
literally, I've lived around the corner on 3rd Street for a very long time, and I used to see Ellen walking her dog all the time, and I was always trying to get her attention, and it took me about 10 years for me to succeed to get her attention. And the way I actually got involved in the theater was, I was walking home one night with groceries along 4th Street, because 3rd Street was so incredibly dangerous that you couldn't walk down 3rd Street, so I would walk and go around the corner, and one night I was coming home, it was early evening, and she was out on the street, and she just pulled me, and she said, "You've got to come in here," and she dragged me inside to 748, to the first floor theater. And there was an incredible show going on. There were only 3 people in the audience. There was a guy named Winston Tom who was doing exquisite work with dolls he had made. And, I saw the show. It just totally changed my life. There are two reasons that I went into the kind of theater I'm making now, which is interdisciplinary theater with puppets. And one of them is Winston Tom at night, and the other is a very early piece by Melvin Lawrence. It's fully coming from my impact with Lamona Theater. So, that's all I'll say for now. When I load in the show, I think I've done more than 20 shows at Lamona. I was doing them every year. And so every time I load in my shows, which are often very, very big with a lot of large objects, all I have to do is go out my front door on 3rd Street and walk down about 50 feet, and it's the back door of Lamona.
Hi, Ezra Clinton, actor, and I was a member of Charles Loves Ridiculous Theatrical Company. And I didn't really have much connection with Lamona, because I joined the company after Charles left here. But Charles always told the story, he was very proud of Alan Stewart. They would be doing drag was illegal at the time. You had to have a cabaret license. And if you got caught, you had to have like one or two articles of clothing of your own gender. Otherwise, you would be thrown in jail, and it was totally illegal. And it's hard to imagine that, but he was always so proud of Ellen. The show would be going on, and Ellen would be downstairs checking for the cops. She would be checking for the cops, and I always, I didn't know Ellen that well. I directed a play as one of the disaster of my life, and she felt sorry for me.
Hey, I'm Mike Mikos. I'm a company member of two ensemble theater companies called Theater Cap and Witness Relocation, both of which have, I think by my last count, I've done 12 shows here in the last 10 years or so, mostly in this room, a few also in the club and in the first floor theater. So I've been really fortunate to have a home here to kind of get a foothold in my own career, starting out as a theater maker, and to be a part of two companies who have had the same opportunity to work in a space of this scale is really unusual and difficult in New York. And I don't know if I have a good laugh line like that, but one of the shows I did here at Theater Cap, I'm not sure if the listener remembers this, but I remember this. We were using the space, this is Major Barber at Theater Cap, and we set the second act downstairs in the lobby, and in one of the intermissions, a man wandered in off of the street into the stairwell where we were in our dressing room, where we were off stage, because we were dressed in like strange kabuki robes with fake kabuki makeup, and he just started talking. He didn't seem to notice that anything was unusual about the way we were dressed. And he just started talking, we were like, hey, I'm so sorry, can you please step outside, we're in the middle of the show right now. And he wouldn't leave until the Lord came charging downstairs with a 4-foot length of 2x4. And that made him leave. New York and start your own theater companies and places, you know, like Walmart or Brooklyn. But I think, like, I don't know much about the conservatory, I've never attended one, but it was so interesting when I came to speak to the students on the first visit that this idea that Ellen Stewart had about, oh, I need something to do the lights, so I need someone to do sound, to do sound. So that's really sort of the philosophy that we have in Stonewall, so that students are really training in more than one thing. They can be a sound designer and an actor, or an actor and a puppeteer, or a puppeteer and a playwright, so that they have more skills and they can be more employable when they get out there. So, you know, you may not get jobs as an actor, but you might as a sound designer.
Romanian student, he goes, stand up. And why don't you sing a Romanian song?
a recommendation that they thought that we would have a connection. We ultimately did not, but she introduced me to someone else who was a spoken word artist in Jakarta, and that person needed help because they wanted to try to link a digitally spoken word artist in California app to do a production in Jakarta. So we helped, and they did that, and it was successful. And then in return, we asked her to perform in our festival that was here in this room. She said, well, I'm not going to be in Jakarta, I'm going to be in a hotel room in Indonesia. And we were like, that's okay. And so she came then, she was a huge face up here, and she performed this beautiful poem inside that festival. And I still haven't met her, I don't know if I ever will. I've met friends that she sent to visit us in New York, but it's a tool, the internet is a tool, that I think has a lot of relevance in terms of connecting. And I think it's also a pathway for artists to actually distribute their expertise to educational institutions in a low impact and low cost way. And I think that we should encourage more of that. So if anyone wants to see the studio and learn more about what we do, I think after this, there'll be a tour at Culture Hub, and Anna Heyman, the managing director, will show you more. So thank you.
Here. A couple things.